Let's get into the Word. As you're turning there to Psalm 103, a few weeks ago we talked about our heart for the kingdom. And God is faithful, and there are many of us that have pledged. There are many of us that have bought into what it is that the Lord is calling us to do this year. And I just want to remind you, if the Lord has spoken to you, I got the numbers from accounting this week, and they gave me the list, and they gave me the numbers and where we are, and there's definitely an opportunity for faith for God to come in and do some things. And I just want to remind you, if this is your place, if this is where God has called you, if this is where God has summoned you, if this is where he has dovetailed our lives together, then it should show up in your wallet as well as your attendance. Amen. Above and beyond your tithe belongs to the Lord. I'm not talking about tithes. But if you believe that it should show up in, listen, I didn't just stand before my wife and give her my heart. I also gave her my wallet. You understand? When I had my children, I didn't just give them a room. I also gave them my wallet. Because love costs something. And if you love this place, and if you love what God is doing, and you love the vision of this house, I just want to encourage, no condemnation, no guilt. If you can't, listen, if you can't afford a dollar, I understand. I'll give you one to give. Because if you'll give, he'll give it back to you in good measure, pressed down, shaken together, shall men give into your lap. He'll put it in your lap. And I just want to encourage you, just take that out there. It should have been in your bulletin, I think, again, on your way in today. And we just want to keep it in front of you. There's the list and the vision of what we're trying to get done. And just let the Holy Spirit lead you and guide you. You ready? Here we go. Psalm chapter 103. And again, I want to remind you that we are trying to memorize these five verses in Psalm 103. That there is a benefit package that comes with being a part of the kingdom of God, and you need to know what it is. Most of us, the reason we either serve him is because we understand the benefits, or the reason we do not really serve him is because we don't understand the benefits. But we're in Psalm 103, chapter 103, verse number 1. He says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name." Verse number 2, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all of his benefits." There are benefits to being in with God. Verse number 3, "Who forgives all iniquities, who heals all diseases, who redeems us from destruction," or redeems our life from destruction, "and who crowns us with loving kindness and tender mercies." But not only does he forgive and he heals and he redeems and he crowns, but the next thing that he does, what does he do? He satisfies my mouth with good things so that my youth is renewed like the eagles. These are the benefits of being a part of the kingdom. And I just want to remind you that you need to know the benefits package. Imagine you being in a job, being employed, being a part of an organization, and you do not even know what you get for being a part of that organization. There are benefits to being a part of the kingdom. Last week we talked about benefit number one, that he forgives most of your iniquities. That's about four of us. He forgives all of our iniquities. Number two, I just want to be honest with you. I have been slaving over this scripture for weeks now, because I got a fundamental struggle with what he says and what I see. Who heals all your diseases. He heals all your diseases. How can a God say that he's going to heal all my diseases, yet this loved one died of cancer? And I prayed for them. And I fasted for them. And I believed God. And I just knew that I felt the presence of the Lord. And they died anyway. How can he say he heals all diseases? Yet I watched my grandmother or my mother or my father spend years in and out of hospitals, getting off work, taking them to places, to doctors, for them to shoot them up with things and burn the insides of their body with chemotherapy until ultimately, and I prayed and I believed and I fasted and I put it on the altar and I just knew in my heart that God, and I buried them anyway. How can he say that he heals all diseases, yet my niece or my nephew, my son or my daughter, my grandchild has been fighting leukemia from birth? And they don't even hardly know what the inside of their room looks like because they have lived in a hospital. Yet he says he heals all diseases. I've warred over this for the past few weeks because it would be real easy for me to preach it. And we can shout Shundai and Edebo all over the floor. Sorry, but it is the balance of reality versus spirituality. For you, for those of you that don't know, my wife has been chronically sick for the last year and a half, losing hair and all. And I have prayed and I have fasted, and we as a congregation have prayed and we have fasted, and we're much more of a holistic kind of person versus doctors and pharmaceuticals and all that kind of stuff, because you know they fix one problem but they create another problem, so we try to do it naturally because that's, but we've gone through every possible thing we can possibly go through, tests, and yet I believe he heals all diseases, but it's not healed. I've warred over this scripture. And to be very transparent, I really wanted to stay away from it or just preach you platitudes and hope you forget reality with a whole lot of hype. Well, let me ask you a question. And this is the question I ask because it is in the context of verse number 3 where he says he forgives all of our iniquities. And in the same verse, he says, who heals all our diseases. Let me ask you a question. Which one do you find it easier to believe God for? Forgiveness of sin? Or that he heals? It's interesting to me that in the same breath, David is writing that he forgives sins and heals diseases. So I went on a journey of how many places we see the forgiveness of sin with the healing of diseases. And it has been very interesting to me that we will find, watch this, we will find over the course of these scriptures how forgiveness of sins and healing of diseases sit in the same context. But before we get to it, I just want to ask you the question up front. Which do you find it easier to believe for? How many of you in this room believe you have been forgiven of all of your iniquities? You believe that you washed it away, washed it whiter than snow, erased the board, kicked away the file cabinet. As far as the east is from the west, he has forgiven you. How many of us in this room, we truly believe that he heals all diseases? Isn't it interesting? He says it in the same thought. Yet we struggle with it in reality. Here's the key. There is a scriptural and spiritual connection between forgiveness of sins and healing of sicknesses. And I want to prove it to you. Listen to this in Isaiah chapter 33, verse number 24. It says, and none there, speaking of Zion, he's talking about Zion, going to the Mount of Zion, the people of God in Mount Zion, the place, the gathering of God with his people, Zion. He's talking about Zion. He says, none there will say, I am sick, healing. And the people who dwell there will be forgiven of their iniquity. Look at the place of Mount Zion where we see healing and forgiveness in the same context. Now, just so you don't think this is about Old Testament, and this is just about, you know, the people of God, the children of Israel, listen to what it says in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 22 and 23. Instead, you have come to Mount Zion, to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to myriads of angels in festive gathering, to the assembly of the firstborn, whose names have been written in heaven, to God, who is the judge of all, to the spirits of righteous people have been made perfect. He's speaking of you and me that have been gathered, the Gentiles, that have been gathered together along with the Jews and the heavenly angels, and we have gathered because our name is written in the book. We have gathered in the same Mount Zion where he promised they would never say, I'm sick, and they could also say they're forgiven. Leroy quoted it just a few minutes ago, Isaiah 53, verse 5, and we used it last week as well. Listen to what he said. But he was in Isaiah 53, 5, but he was wounded. Isaiah, throw it up on the screen for me. He was wounded for our transgressions. And he was bruised for our iniquities. Forgiveness. And the chastisement of our peace was laid upon him. Here it is. And by his stripes we are healed. Look at forgiveness and healing in the same context. In the New Testament, just in case you have a problem with the Old Testament, let me balance it with the New. Here we go. In the New Testament, 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 24, he says, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree. There's forgiveness. He bore our sins in his body on the tree so that having died to sins, we might live for righteousness. You have been healed by his wounds. Again, in the New Testament, we see forgiveness and healing in the same context. Forgiveness of sins and the healing of our body. That word healed, it means in the Greek, and I give you a lot of Greek, I don't really talk about a lot of Greek. In the Greek, it means, the word is sozo, okay, sozo. It looks like soza, but you have a D in there like sozo. And here's what it means. It means that you are made whole, body, soul, and spirit. And when he said that you have been healed, he is saying you have been healed in your body, in your soul, and in your spirit. And when he is talking about healing, he's not talking about just things being done in your body, but he's not leaving out things being done to your body as well. But when he says you are healed, he's saying you are being made whole, sozo. You are being made whole, both body, soul, and spirit. But I can't sit here and say healed without the most important word to me in the text, which is bore. Surely, he bore. The word bore, it means to take up literally and figuratively. In other words, those of you that aren't real sure about this whole spiritual Christian thing, he did not just mean spiritually take up your sickness. Literally, he means he bore the right for you to be made whole, body, soul, and spirit. He bore it. He took up your pain. He took up cancer. He took up AIDS. He took up diabetes. He took up high blood pressure. He took up low blood pressure. He took all of those things and he put him on his back so that you and I could be made whole. We could be healed both body, soul, and spirit. Isaiah 53, verse 4. Because you can't appreciate verse 5 if you don't understand verse 4. He says it this way. He says, surely he has borne, there it is again, he took it up, our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteem him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. Now just in case you're thinking that because he says griefs, he didn't mean sicknesses. The word in the Hebrew actually translates sickness. Out of the 24 times in the Old Testament we see the word grief, 20 of the 24 times it means sicknesses. He has equated sicknesses with sorrow. And he said, I have bore it. I have borne your sickness. New Testament, we see it again in Matthew chapter number 8. I'm just giving you context before we get into the meat. When evening came, they brought him many who were demon-possessed, who drove out spirits with the word and healed all who were sick. So that was spoken by the prophet Isaiah that we just read, that it might be fulfilled. He himself took our weaknesses and bore our diseases. This is what God did. Isn't it amazing how we see forgiveness and healing in the same context? That's great. Question number one. If he heals all, why? You fill in the blank. Why did my father die? If he heals all, why did my son die? If he heals all, why did this person that I love die? And not just die of natural causes, but died of horrible, untimed, ridiculous, in common knowledge. Why? If he heals at all, why? Well, I want to walk us through the journey before we pray today. I hope that I have laid out scriptural precedents where forgiveness of sins and healing of diseases are married in the same context. Well, if forgiveness of sins and healing of diseases are married in the same context, then I believe that the way we walk in our healing is the way we walk in our forgiveness. If forgiveness of sins and healing of diseases have been married in the same context throughout Scripture, then I must believe that the way I walk in forgiveness is also the way I walk in my healing. So the question I must ask you before we can answer if he heals all, why, I must first ask you, are you saved? For if you have been forgiven, the same way you were forgiven, I believe, is the same way you are healed. The way I came to God and he wiped away all of my sin, wiped away all of my shame, took away all of the penalties of those things, is the same way I can walk in the fullness of my healing as well. Let me prove it to you. Number one, how many of you in this room say, I am saved? I am saved. Okay, well, how many of you still struggle with sin, yet you believe you're saved? Well, if you're saved, how can you still struggle with sin? If you're saved and you're still struggling, that means, okay, let me ask you another question. How many of you say, you know what, I've been saved for a long time, but I find myself getting more and more like Christ every day? Okay, so here's how I like to say it. You ready? I like to say it, I am saved, I'm being saved, and I will be saved. Hang on. I am saved, I'm being saved, and I will be saved. In other words, that the moment I surrendered my life to Jesus Christ, in my spirit, remember body, soul, and spirit? In my spirit, I became an eternal living creature for God. I believe that in that moment, old things were passed away and all things were being made new. I believe that he removed my sin as far as the east is from the west. I believe that he utterly destroyed the penalty of sin off of my life. I believe that he wiped all of those things away. But the problem is, I'm not just spirit, I'm also soul and body. And in contrast to my spirit, my body is corrupt. My body is sinful. As a matter of fact, the moment I was born, I began to die. My body and my flesh is so bad that Jesus said, in order for me to get to heaven, I'm going to have a brand new body. Then this thing that is corruptible has to become incorruptible, and this thing that is mortal must take on immortality. In order for me to even make it in, I got to shed my skin of all of this sin stuff so that I can truly walk in the fullness of my redemption. But until the trump of God sounds, I'm still going to war in my flesh. And that's why Paul, who was the greatest apostle, I submit to you, of anyone else, he said, those things that I know I should not do, those are the things I do. And the things that I know I should be doing, those are the things I don't do, because there was a war between his spirit and his body. But when the trumpet of God sounds, in that moment, in a twinkling of an eye, I am going to be raptured and caught away with God. And this thing that is immoral and this thing that is corruptible is going to shed off of me, and I'm going to walk in the purity. But until then, I'm being saved. And be ye transformed by the... So my soul is all about God. My body is all about sin and self. But the battle is for my soul. And as my mind becomes transformed, I become renewed. And the more I understand him, that's why I said, I am saved. I'm being saved. Day by day. Minute by minute, I pray in this moment, in the middle of your sickness or your disease or whatever things that are going to go on, are going on, are going to go on in your life, it is my prayer that this thing transforms you and you are saved just a little bit more until the ultimate day of redemption, where we will ultimately be completely saved. Here's sins and sickness. When he took this on the cross, he bore my sins and my sickness. Here's the way I want to say it. You ready? He bore, come here. Stand right there. I don't know why I picked Goofy Pete. I'm just kidding. You're special. Give me a sign of penalty, a penalty sign, like a whistle, throw the flag. Wow, that looked like John Travolta. That's awesome. All right, come here, Daniel. Yeah, I know, you tried to avoid contact, eye contact, and it worked, didn't work anyway. All right, I want you to give me some power. Just the power. There you go. Boom, boom, fire. Never mind. Okay, and then come here, Alex. Come here. Your hair looks awesome today, by the way. I'm just so jealous. And just stand there like presence. You just have presence. I just want you to have presence. So we got the penalty.
I know, right?
You got the power, and you got the presence. Watch this. This is the penalty of my sin. Throw the flag. This is the power of sin. And this is the presence of sin. The moment I came to Christ, he removed the penalty of my sin. For we know that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus. We know that the wages of sin, the penalty of death, you did good. The penalty of death, it was there. The penalty was there. And we knew that it was death. That was what the penalty was. The penalty was death. It was a penalty of death. Just kidding. And the moment I came into a relationship with Jesus Christ, he completely removed the penalty. Die, boy. He removed the penalty of death. I am saved. I am redeemed. I am washed. I am new. All things are passed away because he has removed the penalty from my life. But the problem is, sin is still present in this earth. Although he broke the penalty from it from my life, the presence of sin is still very, very, very active in the earth today. All you have to do is read a newspaper or turn on a television or look at what happened in our city over the course of the past few weeks. We know that evil and sin is still present, and it is pimping. It's here. And if it's still present, then it still has power. The penalty has been removed from me. But because sin is still present, day by day, I'm being renewed and transformed and broken away from its power. Hang with me, I'm going somewhere. Because I'm trying to pull from the power of this present sin in my life. And that's why I'm transformed and renewed day by day, so that its power is slowly being broken off of me. How many of you in this room can admit, yes, I got saved. Yes, I was forgiven from the penalty of sin, but there's still moments where I succumb to the power of sin. And if you didn't, you're a liar. You're going to burn. I'm just kidding. What in the hell? It's gone. You're a liar, liar, pants on fire. Revelation, revelation. 21, 21, liars go to hell, liars go to hell. Burn, 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 burn. Told you I feel frisky this morning. So I still have to succumb. I still have to break free from the power of sin. Well, if that's true of sin, then it must also be true of sickness, because they live in the same context. So when he took the stripe of healing on my back, thank you, Holy Spirit, he completely removed the penalty of my sin. He completely removed the penalty of my sickness. He removed it. He removed it, and he washed it as far as the east is from the west. And with every lick on his back, cancer was eradicated. The penalty for sin, the penalty for diabetes, the penalty for high, all of that stuff was removed. The penalty of all of those things were gone in the instant that his blood splattered on the ground. But sickness is still present in the earth. And the war that I fight is breaking free from its power. Do you hear what I'm saying this morning? It's the journey of where I'm being renewed. And if my mind can be transformed and my mind can be renewed, little by little I can pull away from the power of a present sickness. Thanks, guys. So let me help us today. And I want you to write this down in all caps, because this makes me angry. I want you to hear the words that are coming out of my mouth. Those are in this room and watching on live stream. Since the penalty of sin and sickness was paid by Jesus, since he was the one who bore it, I want you to hear me. God will never punish his children with sickness. He doesn't punish people with sickness when he bore the penalty for it on the cross. And I am sorry for highly dysfunctional leaders and spiritual leaders that have alluded and assumed and tried to make us feel like the reason why we're going through the sickness we're going through is because we sin somewhere. No, if I have been redeemed and washed by the blood of God, then that penalty has been broken for me, and he would never punish me. It's something he has already had Jesus take the penalty for. Listen to what he said in Exodus 15, 26. I'm giving you a lot of text today because I want you to understand with balance. He said, if you will carefully obey the Lord your God and do what is right in his eyes, pay attention to his commands and keep all of his statutes, I will not inflict any illnesses on you that I inflicted on the Egyptians, for I am Yahweh who heals you. He said, when you are in the beloved and you are a part of the family of God and you receive my payment for the penalty of your sin, I want you to know what has been afflicted to the world is not what I have put on you. I'm not going to punish you with things like the rest of the world that are far from me may have to experience. This is not how I play with my kids. So question number two. If he heals all, then how do I receive my healing? Well, I'll answer your question with a question. How did you receive your forgiveness? For I submit to you that the way you receive your healing is the way you received your forgiveness. If the two have been married throughout Scripture and God talks about them in the context of each other, then I must believe that the way I receive my healing is the way I have received my forgiveness. Oh, well, how did I get forgiven? So glad you asked. We find it in Philippians. Philippians chapter 2, verse number 8 and 9. For you are saved by... Okay. I hope I'm feeling all the thinkers in the room. You're trying to process this. For you have been saved by grace through faith. And this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not from works, so that no man can boast. Because I'm about to blast both of them in a minute. I received my forgiveness by grace. It's by grace. It was in his unmerited favor that he bestowed upon me that I am saved. This by grace. Now the conduit from which it came was through faith. It was by grace, but it was through faith. The only reason I'm sitting here today is not because I have faith. Oh God. It's because I have grace through faith. I have received his grace through faith. It is because by faith I have received his grace. But don't get it twisted. The only reason I can sit here and even act like I got any kind of purity in my life is because of the sheer mercy and grace of God my Savior. Period. By grace. Through faith. By grace. Through faith. So let me help all of us in this room. You are not saved by faith. Oh, I know, I'm treading on charismatic, sacred cows. You are not saved by faith. Your faith did not save you. Because if it was your faith that saved you, you wouldn't even need him. You just needed faith. Do you hear what I'm saying this morning? I got all of this great faith, and I just believe, and I have this faith. That's great. I'm so glad you do, because that means you have a really big conduit for what God wants to do in your life. But the only reason you have had sin washed away is because of the unmerited favor of God and God alone. It is by grace you have been saved. That's why they said it was grace, grace, God's grace. It was amazing grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Not faith. Not faith. Not faith. So if I was saved by grace through faith, then I must be healed by grace through faith. Faith is my part. Grace is God's. And for me to think I'm saved without God's part, what you are is religious. I feel like I'm in a teaching education class today. Mark chapter 6, 5 and 6. Now, he could not do any mighty works there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief, because then he went about the village in a circuit teaching. Watch this. Jesus has come into his own hometown. He's coming to his own hometown, and there was not enough faith in the town for God to perform every miracle. But there was enough faith that he could perform, look at the text, a few. The connotation of that statement means that there were many who were sick that did not get healed. So the question I must ask as a theologian, as a speaker, as a preacher, as a pastor, is what was the issue? Was it the lack of grace? No, he's willing. The issue was the lack of conduit, the lack of faith for him to push grace through. But it was not faith that decided those who would be healed and those would not be healed. It was because of the grace that had to come through faith to get to them. Watch this. Here it is. Faith is the conduit grace runs through. I want you to hear me today. Faith is the conduit that grace runs through. It's the conduit that grace runs through. Let me ask you a question. Think about this for a minute, because I'm going to get here in a minute. By faith you have been made whole. The woman with the issue of blood, rise, your faith has healed you. Rise, you hear all of this stuff about faith. I submit to you, do you think it was faith that did the healing? Or was it the grace and the power of God that came through that faith that provided that healing? Because if it was just faith, well then why were all of those people at the pool of Bethesda not healed? Why would they sit day and night and never experience healing? Because they didn't have enough faith? Well, they wouldn't have even been at the pool if they didn't have enough faith. It was the grace of God that pushed through their faith that brought healing to those people. I wrote it this way because I like word pictures. Faith is the syringe, but grace is the antidote. It is the cure. Did you hear me? Those of us who get our flu shots, it is not the needle that produces the healing. But without the needle, you can't get the cure. Oh God, I hope you hear me today. You go ahead and start playing. Again, for weeks now, I've been warring over this message because I hear the two extremes screaming at me. Extreme number one says it's a work mentality. Extreme number one is works. I can be healed if I eat right, if I sleep right, if I exercise right, if I do all of the things that I need to do and I do it all the right way, I can be healed. In other words, what I'm saying with my works is that God no longer heals, so it's all up to me and my discipline. That is a works mentality. You are walking in a works mentality when you think you and what your disciplines do are contingent upon your healing. It is a works mentality for you to believe that the only way you can be healed is what you do. You're full of works. Full of works. Now, let me balance the room here just for a minute. My body is a gift from God. And not only is it a gift from God, it is also the temple of God. So I should steward it well. But it is not how I treat my body that determines my healing. Health is a benefit from God. And if I believe that I eat, sleep, do all of the things right, listen, I know countless people that were health freaks that still died in an untimely way. One of the most traumatic things for me as a child growing up was a man by the name of Len Bias. on the basketball court, his heart exploded and he died right there on the floor. You're talking about an athlete, you're talking about condition and in shape and eating right, and right there in the middle of the floor, right there in the middle of a basketball game, boom, he dies. You can't tell me divine health comes from works. Now I must be a good steward. I can't go to Bojangles today and order a tailgate special and eat it myself. Sit down, clown. I mean, you can't. Trust me, he can eat it himself. He can eat it himself, trust me. As a matter of fact, if anybody would like to take him to lunch today, give my bank account a break. I can't grab that food and say, God, I curse every calorie in the name of Jesus. I want to taste and see that your divine health, I'm not talking about that either. I've got to be a good steward. But that brings me to the other extreme. The other extreme says, it's all up to my faith. And in the context of this house, I feel like we lean more towards this. I'm just balancing the room. Debate me scripturally later. It's all up to faith. Extreme two, it's all up to faith. If I have enough faith, my faith will work. Well, let me tell you something. Probably the greatest woman of faith in this room is Dania to me. And I watched her, by faith, drag her body in here every single Sunday. You can't tell me she's got a faith problem. You will not convince me that it is a lack of faith between my wife and I that she's not walking in her healing. You cannot convince me that my faith is not strong enough to believe God is able. How could I be preaching it if I didn't believe it like this? You're telling me it's a faith issue? Let me be pastor for a second. Don't you ever wear a Judah Church t-shirt and represent Judah Church, God or me, and walk into somebody who is afflicted and tell them they're weak in their faith. That's why they're not. Don't you ever do that. Don't you ever. You will grab this tiger by the tail. Don't you add more hurt to somebody else who is going through pain. Don't you ever do that. They're in the greatest battle and struggle of their life, and we're going to dump on it too? The devil is a liar. I fired up. My faith will work. Again, I submit to you that if it's all up to your faith, you don't need God. No. Grace will work through faith. Listen to Luke chapter 5, 23. Joshua preached it a few weeks ago with Knock Knock, telling the story of the man that had the roof ripped off of the roof, and the roof that was ripped away, and they lowered the paralytic man down before Jesus. And Jesus caught great controversy over that. And the Pharisees and all the religious people said, who does he think he is that he can heal and forgive in the same moment? Who? It's one thing for you to be a healer. We've seen that. I can't disprove that. But now you're forgiving sins too. See it again? Faith and forgiveness. Healing and forgiveness in the same context. Listen to what Jesus said. He said, which do you think is easier for me? To say your sins are forgiven or to say get up and walk? Forgiveness and healing. And I believe God's question to us this morning is, which is easier for God? God is saying, which is easier for me? To forgive or to heal? I'll answer it for him. Neither. It's neither easier. He can do them both. Not even a snap. Question number three. If he heals all, then what if? What if I still die with this disease? Since sickness and sin is still present, and because it is present, it still has power in the earth. What if he doesn't heal me? What if my son or my daughter still dies? What if we never conceive children? What if, go down the line of whatever your what if is. What if I still die? What if they still die? What if he doesn't remove this? What if? Well, in my house, sitting in our dining room, is a plaque. And it's one of my favorite things. I was in a meeting with Bob a few weeks ago, and I haven't noticed if anybody's ever noticed. And Bob brought it up. It's one of my favorite things. And it's for sale for $7 at Home Access or Hobby Lobby. Maybe. I don't know if it is or not anymore. One of my favorite things. And it simply says, give thanks no matter what. You give, you take away, blessed be the name of the Lord. I will give thanks always, no matter what. No matter what. I'm going to trust God no matter what. I have to trust that he sees further than me, he understands more than me, and he is working his plan to prosper me, give me a hope and a future. He's working all those things for me. Therefore, I will give thanks no matter what. No matter what. Listen to how Paul said it in the book of Philippians. He said it in Philippians 1:20. He said, according to my earnest expectation and hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but with all boldness, as always, no matter what. So now also Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death, no matter what. No matter what, I'm going to trust you. I'm going to trust you to heal me. But I'm still going to trust you no matter what. I will be healed by in this moment, or I will be healed by way of the grave. But one way or the other, I trust you no matter what. No matter what. All my prosperity gospel people, I believe in the prosperity message. I just believe it in a context. 3 John 1 verse 2. He says, beloved, I pray that you may prosper and be in good health, as your soul prospers, that the prosperity of my life in every way is based upon soul prosperity first. I pray that you would prosper and be in good health. Here's my challenge for us today. I want us to stop praying for healing and start praying for health. Healing is a request based upon a need. Health is a benefit that is given to us. Body, soul, I feel the Holy Ghost and Spirit. I want us to stop asking to receive our healing. And I want us to just begin to understand to receive health. I receive health in my body. I receive health in my mind. I receive health in my emotions. I receive health in my finances. I just thank you, God, for divine health that is being released into my life, into my marriage, into my children. Whatever I'm going, I want us to begin to pray for divine health in every way. So in a minute, we're going to pray. We're going to pray. And I'm going to call for my prayer team to come up. And let me tell you what we're going to do. We're going to trust God. And I have been asking God for the last week, Lord, let healings break out. Let divine health run across this room, body, soul, and spirit. But I'm asking you for manifestations of healings to manifest like never. Verifiable miracles that we can have documented, knowing that they were this way in one moment, but you have transformed them in another. I'm asking God for divine miracles to be released in our lives. I'm believing for that. And we're going to call for the prayer team in a minute to come forward. But I want to give you the scriptural connotation for it. It's found it in James chapter 5, verse number 14. It says, is anyone sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. Watch this, 15. And the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Oh my goodness, there's forgiveness and healing again. The prayer of faith will heal the sick. It is the reception of grace through that prayer of faith where healing is received. Today I'm asking you to come to the altar. I'm asking you. And every prayer team member is going to ask you two questions. Question number one, are you here to receive Christ? How can you expect to receive the benefit if you're not even a part of the kingdom where the benefits are for? How presumptuous of me to think that he's going to heal me when I haven't even surrendered to him. So my prayer team, every one of them, first thing they're going to ask you, are you here to receive Christ? And let me be very clear. They're going to ask everyone because I do not want to assume anything. And the reason why I don't want to assume is because I believe that the easiest place to go to hell is in the church. Because we're so conditioned to being religious, there's a way that seems right to a man, but in the end it leads to destruction. So they're going to ask everybody. Number one, are you here to receive Christ? And if you are, we're going to fix that right now. And then question number two, are you here to receive the benefit of divine health? Health that you can't eat right for. Health that you can't exercise enough for. You can't take enough multivitamins for this kind of health. If you are, we're going to pray the prayer of faith. Prayer team, help me right now. We're ready. This is the moment. Are you here to receive Christ? Just line up all the way across the front. And I gave you the scripture in James chapter 5. We've called for our prayer leaders. They're going to anoint with oil, as the scripture has said. A little dab of dew on the forehead. Nothing freaky is going to take place. And I'm believing that when they touch and agree, divine salvation, forgiveness, and divine health is going to flood your life. I'm believing it by faith. Stand with me all over the room if you're physically able. Pray with me right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, pray with me. Right now, let the atmosphere of expectancy, God, be here, Lord. For we know that the spirit of expectancy is the breeding ground for the miraculous. We pray for a saturation of grace in this house today.
We're calling grace, grace, Lord. We're asking for grace to be in this room, unmerited favor, God. Let faith rise in us. I pray, Lord, that the conduit of our faith would be expanded right now. Those that are in this room, those that are watching, those that are listening by podcast later, Lord, I pray that faith would be expanded in this room so more grace could flood. I just pray. Come on, lift your hands all over this room. Lift your hands if you're comfortable all over this room. And I want you just to speak worship to the Lord right now. We're not asking for anything yet. We believe. Come on, come on, come on. Charge the place. Charge the place. Come on, it is your benefit. It is your benefit. It is the benefit.
You are Jesus.
Jesus. Jesus. If you're in this room this morning, body, soul, or spirit, and you're believing for divine health, body, soul, or spirit, I want you just to get out of your seat, and I want you to make your way to the front. Maybe you're far from God. This is a moment. Nobody knows what you're coming up for. I just want you to get out of your seat right now. Come on, get out of your seat and make your way forward. Body, soul, spirit. If you have a loved one that's been imprinted on your mind through this whole service, that's dealing with sickness, they're battling with something, I just want you to get out of the seat, and I want you to tell them this is who we're praying for. Come on, come on. You won it all.
You have won it all for me. Death could not hold you down. You are the risen King. You're seated in majesty.
Jesus, 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 Jesus. We believe, God. We believe. We believe, oh Lord. We have faith, God. Faith is rising. Nothing is possible. Possible for you. Nothing
I believe
is.
You are all I need.
Come on, baby, come on, come on. I believe you're my portion.
Yes, you are.
destruction, who crowns my head with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies my mouth with good things, so that my youth is renewed like the eagles. Oh, bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, forget not all his benefits, who forgives all my iniquities, who heals all my diseases, who redeems my life from destruction, who crowns my head with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies my mouth with good things, who renews my strength like the eagles. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. I bless his holy name. I bless the Lord, oh my soul, and I forget not all his benefits, who forgives my iniquities, who heals my diseases, who redeems my life from destruction, who crowns my head with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies my mouth with good things, so that my youth
is renewed like the eagles. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Who forgives my iniquities, who heals my diseases, who redeems my life from destruction, who crowns my head with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies my mouth with good things, so that my youth is renewed like the eagles. We bless you, Jesus. We bless you, Jesus. We bless you, Jesus. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. I want to do one last thing before we dismiss this morning. Two last things. Number one, and I just felt prompted of the Lord. If you're in this room and you are having a difficult time conceiving, I want to pray with you this morning. I just felt prompted of the Lord that conception was an issue. And those of you that just know this house, I'm not being funny right now. Conception was an issue. I want to pray with you, my wife and I. It's just something, it's a grace that the Lord has set on us. And I just, is there anybody? I just want to make sure I'm being obedient. Okay, come here. I didn't even think one thing about you. I just felt prompted of the Lord that this is a moment. I forgot all about you. That makes sense. I'm glad I heard and not just thought. That's one of the graces that the Lord has just put on him and I to pray for people to conceive. I'm looking at Travis and Laura holding baby number two. And I remember sitting in Washington, D.C. that day. We prayed for you. You know, I'm looking at Justin and Ashley. And, you know, Hey Jude is not anywhere around them at this moment. He's in kids' church. As a matter of fact, I want both of you to come stand behind them. Joshua and Kathy, I remember many times praying, prayer of faith. And God is no respecter of persons. And I just remember, and I want us to pray. And I'm just going to pray the way we always pray. She always puts her hand on the belly, and I'll put my hand on top of her hand. And we're just going to believe. We're going to believe God. And there are witnesses behind you. Look at that little girl. He is able. He is able. He is able. He is able. It is your benefit. Children are a heritage from the Lord. And I just believe, I wish Andrew was standing right here beside you. I just believe by faith that it shall come to pass. Though it tarry, wait for it, for it shall come to pass. Point your hands in this direction, will you? Maybe put your hand right there. Come on. Father, in the name of Jesus, we awaken this womb. And we stir up the gift of God on the inside of her. Like Hannah, God, you see her tears. And I pray, Lord, that she would hear from heaven today. I pray that the promise would be fulfilled. For you have given her the desire of this heart in her heart, Lord. And I pray in the name of Jesus that it shall come to pass in season. It shall come to pass. We decree it. We expect it. And I thank you for it by faith right now in the name of Jesus. We decree it. It is so. We call heaven and earth to attention. It is so in the name of Jesus. Thank him, Ashley. I just want you to thank him. Thank him. Just thank him. We thank you. We remove the spirit of heaviness. We remove pressure. We remove anxiety. We remove the spirit that would try to force things to take place. But we remove this burden, for his yoke is easy. And we say, you shall have peace. In the name of Jesus. In season. In season. In cycle, in season, we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Last thing, I know we've gone a little bit over this morning. I want you to say this with me the best you can from your memory. Throw it up on the screen just to be safe if you want. But I want this thing to resonate in your spirit. And you don't understand yet, but this is a five-step process to Eagle Strength Renewed. That's what this is. Those of you that are clinical and you need to have some clinical stuff, psychology stuff, let me give you five steps. Number one, he will forgive. Number two, he will heal. Number three, he will redeem. I can't wait till the next week. Not only does he forgive, he redeems. Cannot wait. He will forgive, he will heal, he will redeem, and then he will crown, and then he will satisfy so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. I want you, from the best of your ability, I want you to get this in your spirit. It's your benefits package. It's what is not owed you, but it is what is due you. These are yours. It is due you. He says it this way. Come on, say it with me. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all iniquities, who heals all diseases, who redeems your life from destruction, who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, who satisfies your mouth with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Father, we thank you for our benefits. We thank you for our benefits. Thank you for the benefits of being called your child. We praise you for it. And now, according to Deuteronomy 1:11, I say, may the Lord God of your fathers make you 1,000 times more than what you are. And may he fulfill every promise that he has given you. We ask these things in the matchless name of Jesus, our healer. And everyone who loved the Lord said amen.
You have just seen the word of God, I pray, come alive. And I don't want to leave this moment. I didn't want to leave you leaving this video without a moment for you to maybe make Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior of your life. It's real simple. All you have to do is ask him to come into your life, believe that he is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and confess your need from him and the fact that you've been far from him. And today I pray that that would happen and take place in your life. But before you leave, I also wanted to do one thing that we do at the conclusion of every service, which is speak the Deuteronomy 1:11 blessing over your life. And I say, may the God of your fathers make you 1,000 times more than what you are and fulfill every promise that he has given you. We love you. God bless you. We hope you check out more videos. And if there's anything we can ever do, please email us at info@judachurch.org.